One prison officer said it was easier to buy heroin inside Brixton Prison than it was outside Brixton McDonald's.
One of Britain's biggest prisons was actually known inside as Carphone Warehouse because it was so easy to get hold of mobile phones in there.
My investigation revealed how a corruption epidemic inside the prison walls of every prison in the UK was being kept a secret by the UK government.
Britain's entire prison system was riddled from top to bottom with corruption.
A system that is supposed to rehabilitate was doing the exact opposite of what it was in place to do.
My name's Heidi Blake, and I'm an investigative reporter and editor at BuzzFeed News. Richard was a very young reporter. He was fresh out of university, and we'd originally hired him as an intern. And he came bouncing into the office one day with this idea for a story.
My name is Richard Holmes, and I'm an investigative reporter at BuzzFeed News. During this time, there was a lot of interest in prisons. Everyone was talking about drugs coming into prisons, and there was a lot of reports about drones and very complex methods of getting drugs into prisons. But no one was really talking about an obvious route, which I thought would be the most popular, which is corrupt staff. So I decided to use a tool that's very useful for journalists and members of the public, which is freedom of information.
But the government refused to disclose how many corruption reports had been filed against prison officers and how many of those had actually been acted upon, because to do so would show weaknesses in their ability to respond to corruption, which might actually encourage criminals to try to corrupt prison officers. And that was when we thought, wow, bingo, we're really onto something here.
I was never in any doubt that there were drugs or mobile phones inside prisons. But prisoners themselves were posting selfies, holding drugs or smoking drugs. And there was a whole swath of social media accounts that were run by prisoners inside prisons. There were two sets of documents throughout the reporting stage. One was a large batch of security information reports coming out of Pentonville Prison that an interested party had felt the need to share with me. That was the first time when I had actually ever received a leak.
The documents were full of really eye-popping details about the kind of corruption that was going on inside prisons.
Allegations of prison officers supplying prisoners with heroin and other hard drugs, cocaine, crack.
There were allegations that prison officers were assisting prisoners with escape attempts by either supplying them with prison guard uniforms to help them get out, or arranging hospital visits where it's much easier for them to escape because there's lower security.
Reports of prison officers having sexual relations with prisoners. And there were even several reports of prison officers bringing in weaponry and ammunition.
These documents showed that Britain's entire prison system was riddled from top to bottom with corruption, and that the governors and the independent monitors who were in charge of stamping out that kind of corruption were totally failing to do anything to stop it.
The majority of people in the prison system didn't want to talk to me. When you join the prison system, you have to sign the Official Secrets Act, which makes it a criminal offence to reveal sensitive information about your place of work. But there were individuals who were overly concerned about this very issue.
But the main corruption that I saw personally was a huge amount of drugs. Alcohol, when you find fruit which has been injected with large quantities of vodka, there's only one way that's coming.
I went to Heidi and sort of said, you know, I had spoken to one, I've got one to speak to me, and they told me X, Y, and Z.
I'd be like, great, go and find another 10 prison officers and I want an inmate as well.
I managed to get to speak to 32 insiders from over 10 prisons across the UK. There's two main points in this story, and that's the initial corruption that's being undertaken by the prison officers. But the bigger systemic issue, in my opinion, is the fact that this corruption is not being reported properly.
I did a security information report on information that I'd received about an officer dealing drugs. And then I found myself in front of the governor explaining why I'd submitted that report. I felt quite undermined by that action. Because they're behind a big wall, very rarely do you hear anything about it. It's covered up in many different ways.
It started to make sense to me that there was a real systemic problem with reporting corruption inside prisons. And it was pretty shocking, to be honest with you.
The documents show that prison officers had all kinds of different ways of getting these contraband items into prisons, having corrupt relationships with the prison officers who undertook the searches, who maybe would turn off the electronic scanners when you were coming in so that they wouldn't pick up on any weapons you had concealed, who maybe would skip routine searches so that you could get through.
Drugs are also thrown over the fences with the knowledge that that certain prison officer is on duty and will go and pick that package up.
One corrupt prison guard told Richard that he was originally asked just to bring in a dressing gown.
When that prisoner received the clothing, they opened it and mobile phones just spilled out. And once that happened, that prison officer was got and they now worked for that prisoner, essentially.
There were also allegations about drugs and phones and weapons being concealed in confectionery packets and, you know, on officers' bodies. There was one officer who told Richard, if you want to be extra safe, you can just stick it up your arse. There's a price for any kind of corrupt service you might want to procure in prison.
You could buy a very cheap burner phone for £200 to £300.
If you've got about £1,500, you can get hold of a smartphone.
If you were willing to spend £5,000, you could even get yourself transferred to a less secure wing or prison.
And if you can get hold of £10,000, that's what it costs to hire a prison officer to assist you in an actual escape attempt.
I think it's important to say that, you know, not every prison officer is corrupt, and it's actually the large percentage of prison officers are just trying to do a good job.
99.9% of prison officers are honest and extremely professional. They are dedicated to their trade of looking after people in their custody. However, the continual erosion through investment by consecutive governments, without a doubt, has caused the prison estate to crumble.
This is a very low-paid job. Prison officers start, you know, on about £24,000 a year, and they're working under incredibly stressful and dangerous conditions.
People join the service, a vast majority in good faith, and they are then pushed into a position of corruption where they are manipulated by the people they're looking after. And the financial gains are quite large, aren't they?
So there's three ways prison officers can become corrupt. One, they are slowly groomed by a prisoner, starting off with something harmless and leading up to, you know, hard drugs or weaponry. Two, prison officers are intimidated by criminals and prisoners inside the prison walls. And three, they're planted there by criminal gangs themselves with the full intention of working for a prisoner while they work for the prison service.
And, you know, we could see clearly how tempting it would be when you were working under that kind of stress for such low pay to give in and kind of agree to start doing corrupt deals with prisoners to make a bit of extra money. But we could also see it wasn't just about the financial incentive to be corrupt. There was also real fear involved. I mean, some of these prison officers were being repeatedly beaten up by prisoners. They were being threatened and intimidated.
Those drugs or weapons will flow around the prison system, causing the drug epidemic that we've seen in recent years, and leading to a bigger demand. And then you have more prisoners wanting to get their hands on drugs, and more prison officers being offered money, being offered services, goods, and the spiral of corruption continues. You know, no one's winning here. I mean, even the people who receive the payout at the end, they're still finding themselves working from inside the prison. They're heavily involved with criminal enterprises. There are no winners. It's just all losers.
Richard's article was published in December of 2016, and it met with widespread outrage across the political spectrum. There were calls for a major government intervention to crack down on the corruption that he'd exposed. Since then, the government has established an anti-corruption task force in prisons. And finally, the government has decided to come clean about the volume of corruption reports that are filed against prison officers every year. We now know that there are 7,000 of those corruption reports each year against officers in Britain's prisons. So it's great that the government is finally taking action to crack down, but pretty shocking that it took this long and it took investigative reporting like Richard's to really bring this issue to light.